This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. An overhead line or overhead wire is used to transmit electrical energy to trams, trolleybuses, or trains. It is known variously as overhead contact system OCS, overhead line equipment OL or OHLE, overhead equipment OHE, overhead wiring OHW, or overhead lines OL, catenary trolley wire. In this article, the generic term overhead line is used, as used by the International Union of Railways. Overhead line is designed on the principle of one or more overhead wires or rails, particularly in tunnels situated over rail tracks, raised to a high electrical potential by connection to feeder stations at regular intervals. The feeder stations are usually fed from a high-voltage electrical grid. Contents 1. Overview 2. Construction 21. Parallel overhead lines. 3. Tensioning 4. Brakes 41. Section brake 42. Neutral section phase brake 43. Dead section 44. Gaps 5. Overhead conductor rails 6. Crossings 61. Australia 62. Greece 63. Italy 7. Multiple overhead lines 8. Overhead catenary 81. Height 9. Problems with overhead equipment 10. History 11. See also 12 references. 13. Further reading 14. External links. Overview. Electric trains that collect their current from overhead lines use a device such as a pantograph, bow collector, or trolley pole. It presses against the underside of the lowest overhead wire. The contact wire current collectors are electrically conductive and allow current to flow through to the train or tram and back to the feeder station through the steel wheels on one or both running rails. Non-electric locomotives such as diesels may pass along these tracks without affecting the overhead line, although there may be difficulty with overhead clearance. Alternative electrical power transmission schemes for trains include third rail, ground level power supply, batteries, and electromagnetic induction. This article does not cover regenerative braking, where the traction motors act as generators to retard movement and return power to the overhead third rail to overhead wire transition zone on the Skokie Swift construction lineman on a maintenance of way vehicle repairing overhead lines. Poland. To achieve good high-speed current collection, it is necessary to keep the contact wire geometry within defined limits. This is usually achieved by supporting the contact wire from a second wire known as the messenger wire in the US. Either side of the messenger, catenary wire compound equipment, uses a second support wire, known as the auxiliary. Between the messenger, catenary wire and the contact wire, droppers support the auxiliary from the messenger wire, and additional droppers support the contact wire from the auxiliary. The auxiliary wire can be of a more conductive but less wear-resistant metal, increasing the efficiency of power transmission. Dropper wires traditionally provide physical support of the contact wire without joining the catenary and contact wires. Electrically contemporary systems use current-carrying droppers, which eliminate the need for separate wires. The present transmission system originated about 100 years ago. A simpler system was proposed in the 1970s by the Pirelli Construction Co., consisting of a single wire embedded at each support for 25.8 meters. An electrical circuit requires at least two conductors. Trams and railways use the overhead line as one side of the circuit and the steel rails as the other side of the circuit. For a trolleybus, there are no rails for the return current. The vehicles use rubber tires and the normal road surface. Trolleybuses use a second parallel overhead line for the return, and two trolley poles, one contacting each overhead wire. The circuit is completed by using both wires. Parallel overhead wires are also used on railways with three-phase AC railway electrification, which is rare. Tensioning line tensioning in Germany. Catenary wires are kept at a mechanical tension because the pantograph causes mechanical oscillations in the wire and the wave must travel faster than the train to avoid producing standing waves that would cause wire breakage. Tensioning the line makes waves travel faster for medium and high speeds. The wires are generally tensioned by weights or occasionally by hydraulic tensioners. Either method is known as auto tensioning at or constant tension and ensures that the tension is virtually independent of temperature. Tensions are typically between 9 and 20. Equipment may be used, with the wires terminated directly on structures at each end of the overhead line. The tension is generally about 10. Downward pull of the weights and the reactive upward pull of the tensioned wires lifts the pulley so its teeth are well clear of a stop on the mast. The pulley can turn freely while the weights move up or down as the wires contract or expand. If tension is lost, the pulley falls back toward the mast, and one of its teeth jams against the stop. This stops further rotation, limits the damage, and keeps the undamaged part of the wire intact until it can be repaired. Other systems use various braking mechanisms, usually with multiple smaller pulleys in a block and tackle Vehicle Arrangement Brake Section Brake. A section insulator at a section brake in Amtrak's 12 kV catenary to allow maintenance to the overhead line without having to turn off the entire system. The line is broken into electrically separated portions known as sections. Sections often correspond with tension lengths as described above. The transition from section to section is known as a section brake and is set up so that the vehicle's pantograph is in continuous contact with the wire for bow collectors and pantographs. This is done by having two contact wires run side by side over the length of three or four wire supports. A new one drops down and the old one rises up, allowing the pantograph to smoothly transfer from one to the other. The two wires do not touch. Although the bow collector pantograph is briefly in contact with both wires in normal service, the two sections are electrically connected to different substations if at or near the halfway mark between them, but this can be broken for servicing on overhead wires designed for trolley poles. This is done by having a neutral section between the wires, requiring an insulator. The driver of the tram or trolleybus must turn off the power when the trolley pole passes through, to prevent arc damage to the insulator. Pantograph equipped locomotives must not run through a section brake when one side is de-energized. The locomotive would become trapped, but as it passes the section brake, the pantograph will briefly short the two catenary lines together. If the opposite line is de-energized, this voltage transient may trip supply breakers. If the line is under maintenance, injury may occur as the catenary is suddenly energized even if the catenary is properly grounded. The arc generated across the pantograph will likely cause damage to the pantograph, the catenary insulator, or both. Neutral section phase brake. Neutral section indication board used on railways in the UK, sometimes on a larger electrified railway, tramway or trolleybus system. It is necessary to power different areas of track from different power grids, the synchronization of the phases of which cannot be guaranteed. Sometimes the sections are powered with different voltages or frequencies. There may be mechanisms for having the grid synchronized on a normal basis, but events may cause desynchronization. This is no problem for DC systems, but for AC systems it is highly undesirable to connect two unsynchronized grids. A simple section brake is insufficient to guard against this, as the pantograph briefly connects both sections. A neutral section or phase brake is used, consisting of two section brakes back to back with a short section of overhead line that belongs to neither grid. If the two grids are synchronized, this stretch of line is energized by either supply and trains run through it normally. If the two supplies are not synchronized, it is disconnected from the supplies, leaving it electrically dead, ensuring that the two grids cannot be connected to each other. The sudden loss and then reconnection to the supply over the neutral section might cause damage to the locomotive if it was drawing power, so signs warn the driver when synchronization is lost and the phase brake is de-energized. The driver should put the controller throttle into neutral and coast through the section. On the Pennsylvania Railroad, phase brakes were indicated by a position light signal face with all eight radial positions with lenses and no center light. When the phase brake was active, the catenary sections out of phase, all lights were lit. The position light signal aspect was originally devised by the Pennsylvania Railroad and was continued by Amtrak and has been adopted by Metro North. Metal signs were hung from the catenary supports with the letters PB, created by a pattern of drilled holes in countries such as France, South Africa and the United Kingdom. Permanent magnets beside the rails at either side of the neutral section operate a bogie-mounted transducer on the train, which causes a large electrical circuit breaker to open and close when the locomotive or the pantograph vehicle of a multiple unit passes them. Dead section. A special category of phase brake was developed in American practice, primarily by the Pennsylvania Railroad, since its traction power network was centrally supplied and only segmented by abnormal conditions. Normal phase brakes were generally not active. Phase brakes that were always activated were known as dead sections. They were often used to separate power systems. For example, the Hell's Gate Bridge boundary between Amtrak and Metro North's electrifications that would never be in phase, since a dead section is always dead. No special signal aspect was developed to warn drivers of its presence, and a metal sign with DS in drilled hole letters was hung from the catenary supports. Gaps. A swing bridge near Meppel, the Netherlands. There is no overhead line on the bridge. The train coasts through with raised pantograph. Occasionally gaps may be present in the overhead lines, when switching from one voltage to Another or to provide clearance for ships at movable bridges, as a cheaper alternative for movable overhead power rails electric trains have to coast through to prevent arcing. Power must be switched off before reaching the gap. Usually the pantograph must be lowered too, but this is not always the case. Overhead conductor rails where there is limited clearance such as in tunnels, the overhead wire may be replaced by rigid overhead rail. This was done when the overhead line was raised in the Simplon Tunnel to accommodate taller rail vehicles. A rigid overhead rail may also be used in places where tensioning the wires is impractical, for example on movable bridges. Short overhead conductor rails are also installed at tram stops, as for the Combino Supra crossings tram overhead wire diagonal crossing trolleybus wires horizontal, photographed in Bahnhofplatz, Bern, Switzerland. Annotated version of the above photo, highlighting components. From two overhead wires at a similar voltage, and at least one of the trolleybus wires must be insulated from tram wires. This is usually done by the trolleybus wires running continuously through the crossing, with the tram conductors a few centimeters lower close to the junction on each side. The tram wire turns into a solid bar running parallel to the trolleybus wires for about half a meter. Another bar similarly angled at its ends is hung between the trolleybus wires, electrically connected above to the tram wire. The tram's pantograph bridges the gap between the different conductors, providing it with a continuous pickup where the tram wire crosses. The trolleybus wires are protected by an inverted trough of insulating material extending 20 or 30. That the crossing is electrically dead. Australia. Many cities had trams and trolleybuses using trolley poles. They used insulated crossovers, which required tram drivers to put the controller into neutral and coast through. Trolleybus drivers had to either lift off the accelerator or switch to auxiliary power. In Melbourne, Victoria, tram drivers put the controller into neutral and coast through section insulators, indicated by insulator markings between the rails. Melbourne has three level crossings between electrified suburban railways and tram lines. They have mechanical switching arrangements. Changeover switch to switch the 1500 volts DC overhead of the railway and the 650 volts DC of the trams, called a tram square. Proposals have been put forward which would see these crossings grade separated or the tram routes diverted. Greece. In Athens, there are two crossings between tram and trolleybus wires, at Vas Amalias Avenue and Vas Olgas Avenue, and at Ardito Street and Athanasiou Diakos Street. They use the above-mentioned solution from the opening of the tram system in the summer of 2004. Trams and trolleybuses in the direction of Pagrati shared the same exclusive lane, about 400 meters long, on the far right side of Vas Olgas Avenue, with tram and trolleybus wires side by side above a narrow lane of road. The trolleybus wires were on the far right of the lane, away from the tram's very wide pantographs. Trolleybus drivers were required to drive very slowly because the trolley poles were extended to their limits. A change of route for trolleybuses was implemented in mid-2005, ending this arrangement. Italy. In Rome, at the crossing between Viale Regina Margherita and Via Nomentana, tram and trolleybus lines cross as well. Tram on Viale Regina Margherita and trolleybus on Via Nomentana. The crossing is orthonal, therefore the arrangement seems before was not available in Milan. Most tram lines cross its circular trolleybus line once or twice. Trolleybus and tram wires run parallel in streets such as Viale Stevio and Viale Tibaldi. Multiple overhead lines. Two overhead conductor rails for the same track. Left, 1200 volts DC for the Uetliberg railway. The pantograph is mounted asymmetrically to collect current from this rail. Right, 15 phases of the three-phase AC. While the rail was used for the third phase, the neutral was not used. Some three-phase AC railways used three overhead wires. These were an experimental railway line of Siemens in Berlin-Lichtenberg in 1898, length 18 kilometers, the military railway between Marienfeld and Sassen between 1901 and 1904, length 234 kilometers, and an 800-meter-long section of a coal railway near Cologne between 1940 and 1949 on DC systems. Bipolar overhead lines were sometimes used to avoid galvanic corrosion of metallic parts near the railway, such as on the Chemin de Fer de la Mure. All systems with multiple overhead lines have high risk of short circuits at switches and therefore tend to be impractical in use, especially when high voltages are used or when trains run through the points at high speed. The Siltel-Zurich-Uetliberg Bahn has two lines with different electrification to be able to use different electric systems on shared tracks. The Siltel line has its overhead wire wire right above the train, whilst the Uetliberg line has its overhead wire off to one side. Overhead catenary overhead feeding rail on the RER line. See trenches and tunnels in central Paris. Compound catenary equipment of junior west overhead lines mean that historic images are no longer recreatable on many lines, such as in this recreation of a 1960s scene of a steam express in Berwick-upon-Tweed, United Kingdom. However, photo editing software can facilitate the removal of such lines from the image. A catenary is a system of overhead wires used to supply electricity to a locomotive, streetcar, or light rail vehicle, which is equipped with a pantograph. Unlike simple overhead wires, in which the uninsulated wire is attached by clamps to closely spaced crosswires supported by poles, catenary systems use at least two wires. The catenary or messenger wire is hung at a specific tension between line structures, and a second wire is held in tension by the messenger wire, attached to it at frequent intervals by clamps and connecting wires known as droppers. The second wire is straight and level, parallel to the rail track. Suspended over it is the roadway of a suspension bridge. As over water, simple wire installations are common in light rail, especially on city streets, while more expensive catenary systems are suited to high-speed operations. The Northeast Corridor in the United States has catenary over the 600 miles 1,000 of steam trains passing through Cleveland. Between the East Coast and Chicago, trains switched from steam to electric locomotives at the Collinwood rail yards about 10 miles 16. Problems with overhead equipment. Overhead line equipment can be adversely affected by strong winds causing swinging wires. Power storms can knock the power out with lightning strikes on systems with overhead wires, stopping trains. If there is a power surge during cold or frosty weather, there is a risk of ice buildup on overhead lines. This can result in poor electrical contact between the collector and the overhead line, resulting in electrical arcing and power surges. Overhead line equipment may require reconstruction of bridges to provide safe electrical clearance. Overhead equipment, like most electrified systems, requires a greater capital expenditure when building the system than an equivalent non-electric system. While a conventional rail line requires only the grade, ballast, ties and rails, an overhead system also requires a complex system of support structures, lines, insulators, power control systems, and power lines, all of which require maintenance over time. This makes non-electrical systems more attractive in the short term, although electrical systems can pay for themselves eventually. In most cases also, the added construction and maintenance cost per mile makes overhead systems less attractive on long-distance railways, such as many of those found in North America, where the distances between cities are typically far greater than in Europe. Such long lines would require enormous investment in overhead line equipment, and there are major difficulties in energizing long portions of overhead wire on a permanent basis, especially in areas where energy demand already far outstrips supply. Many people also consider overhead lines to be visual pollution, due to the many support structures and complicated system of wires and cables which fill the air over an overhead powered rail line or trolley system. It is such considerations that have driven the move towards replacing overhead power and communications lines with buried cables in many areas. An opposition to overhead power is strong in many areas. History. The first tram with overhead lines was presented by Werner von Siemens at the International Electric Exposition in Paris 1881. The installation was removed after that event in October 1883. The first permanent tram service with overhead lines was on the Modeling and Hinterbrühl tram in Austria. The trams had bipolar overhead lines, consisting of two U-pipes, in which the pantographs hung and ran like shuttles. In April to June 1882, Siemens had tested a similar system on his Electromote, an early precursor of the trolleybus. Much simpler and more functional was an overhead wire in combination with a pantograph borne by the vehicle and pressed at the line from below. This system, for rail traffic with a unipolar line, was invented by Frank J. Sprague in 1888. From 1889 it was used at the Richmond Union Passenger Railway in Richmond, Virginia, pioneering electric traction. See also electro-diesel locomotive lineman technician. List of current systems for electric rail traction. Railway electrification system references. UIC English, French, German thesaurus. Siemens press release. TMSV, tramway level crossings in Victoria. Camera systems. Skal Advair Lokofuriri Mod Svingend Karelidninger på Storbile, in Danish. 5 November 2013. Retrieved 25 June 2016. 16. Wikimedia Commons has media related to overhead lines https://RAL-Electricacom/Traction-Distribution/Over-Head-Equipment-Neutral-Section/HTTP:/Earth-Corg/Fac/Fac-Electmel-VE-Railway-Electrification topics. List of systems: Railway electrification system, Railway electric traction, Traction power network, Traction substation, Power car, Electric locomotive, Electric multiple unit, Electro-diesel locomotive, Multi-system. Overhead line, Trolley, Pole, Bow, Collector, Pantograph, Third rail, Fourth rail, Conduit, Current, Collection, Ground level, Power supply, Stud, Contact system, Contact shoe, By country, Austria, Australia, Great Britain, France, Germany, India, Iran, Japan, Malaysia, Norway, Timeline, Russia, Switzerland, Sweden, Turkey, United States, VE, Railway infrastructure, permanent way, history, permanent way, current railroad tie, sleeper rail, fastening system, track ballast, rail profile, fish plate, breather switch, date nail, axe ties, ladder track, Bach road, cant, minimum radius, track transition, curve clip and scotch, trackwork and track structures, junction Y, railroad switch, gauntlet track, railway electrification system, third rail, overhead lines, guide bar, track gauge, track geometry, railway turntable, water crane, track pan, rail track, tramway track, classification yard, rail yard, siding, passing loop, balloon loop, headshunt, refuge siding, dual gauge rollway, signaling and safety, derail, railway signaling, signaling control, wayside horn, railway signal, interlocking level crossing, buffer stop, catch points, loading gauge, structure gauge, block post, train stop, signal bridge, buildings, railway station, station building, railway station layout, station clock, train shed, goods shed, motive power depot, roundhouse, railway platform.